Welcome to a Creating Patient Access Task Force Mental Health Exclusive. Special thanks to our partners for joining us live. So I am your host, Mia Maysack, or M.A., founder of Keeping Our Heads Up, creator of Peace and Love Wellness. I am a writer, speaker, and education and legislative committee member and leader for CPATF. Our mission being to promote collaborative work together in pursuit of health and access for all. So I'm thrilled to be here with you all, and as well as having an all-star on the line with me, who I'm going to tell you a little bit about. A five-time worldwide boxing champion. Fighter in both the ring and in life, an advocate, actress, radio show host, activist, a conqueror in every sense of the word. She has been featured on the cover of International Pain Foundation's I Pain Living Winter 2020 magazine for turning heartbreak into healing as a true mental health hero. With the belief that knowledge is power, she not only continues to learn from her own struggles, but has dedicated her life to educate, raise awareness, drive change, and give hope. So it is nothing short of a genuine honor to introduce the one and the only Mia St. John.
Hey!
Hello! Thank you so much for taking the time to be with us today. We greatly appreciate it.
Thank you.
So, I just got to tell you that I read your story, and I was inspired, heartbroken, sad, empowered. There are some parallels between us in regards to pain and triumph, not to mention both of our names are Mia.
Oh, wow.
So, no missing in action happening here, huh? So, you know, I have to tell you, what stands out to me the most about you is your authenticity, the candidness within your demeanor, the fearlessness, or at least the lack of succumbing to it, right? It's highly respectable how you're not afraid to speak the truth, regardless of how difficult or uncomfortable it may be. And it's these connections and these meaningful conversations that really save lives. So I'd love to start out by asking you, given your well-rounded experience, what does mental health mean to you?
When I think of mental health, I think of somebody who is mentally healthy, free of anxiety, depression, mental illness, a word used or changed from mental illness to mental health by the government to expand funding to cover all people rather than just the seriously mentally ill. It was so that we could cover those that suffer from episodes of depression, anxiety, and not necessarily schizophrenia, bipolar. That's what I think of when I think of mental health.
That's great. So you're someone living with some physical pain.
I've suffered many, many concussions over the years, but I don't know what the damage is. I suffer from severe arthritis. I've had 3 hip replacements. But yeah, something I live with. It was a choice I made long ago that that's what I was going to do with my body, and that's what I did. And now I have the repercussions of my choices.
Yes, indeed. And we all have choices, and we have to weigh the pros and cons of those choices. And I don't think you make it to being a 5-time world champion without, you know, a few bruises along the way. But
right. We know what the consequences are ahead of time. But you know, when you're young, you think that you're invincible. It's not going to happen to me.
Right. That's one thing life is very good at. It's humbling us, you know, through our experiences. So you also cope with an aspect of mental illness.
Yes. And I don't know if I wouldn't call myself mentally ill. I'd say I suffer from bouts of OCD, obsessive compulsive disorder, generalized anxiety disorder, and panic disorder from time to time. There are times when I say, you know, I'll tell my sister I'm sick these last few months or whatever. And by that, she knows what I mean. Because it's not all year round. They're bouts of these illnesses.
You know, I feel, and maybe you agree, that we all as humans, to a certain extent, at different times in our lives, maybe have bouts of our own in different ways.
Exactly. Exactly. I've never met a person who has said, I've never, ever suffered depression, never suffered anxiety. There's usually, throughout their lives, has suffered something, unless you're one of those lucky ones that never had anything, I guess. That's possible.
Right. Not that we'd wish anything on anyone, but, you know, we definitely develop a special skill set having endured special circumstances, I guess you could say. So then there's the aspect of the whole alcoholism and the addiction. Can you tell me a little bit more about that?
I don't want to say I knew I was an alcoholic, but I started drinking at the age of 10. And I kind of knew something was off because I had a hard time stopping even at that age. And it progressively got worse as I got older. I stayed sober for 30 years, thankfully, and was able to raise 2 children sober. I recently relapsed, but I always thank the universe that I had those 30 years that I was able to live my entire career drug and alcohol free and raise my kids drug and alcohol free.
That's a huge accomplishment, and I feel that, again, as humans, we all kind of relapse in our own ways throughout our journey, and I don't feel that a slip-up takes away from that accomplishment and that victory that you earned for yourself.
Right.
So that's got to be rough, though, you know, especially maybe in times such as COVID where there's not access, right, to very important meetings, but yet we can go to the liquor store.
Right. I mean, yes, and I've been very vocal about it. I relapsed during the coronavirus, and I'm now suing the mayor of L.A. for not deeming our AA meetings essential and being shut down. And I feel that, you know, we have over 3 million people globally that die every year from alcohol-related deaths, far more than the coronavirus. So if that's not essential, I don't know what is, you know. I mean, all lives matter, in my opinion.
And we wouldn't have wished a pandemic or anything to happen, but I do feel that it may be exposing some of the things that definitely maybe aren't necessarily new problems, but are very real problems that need to be addressed. So I'm very grateful that you're out there and being so vocal about that, because especially in times of isolation, it makes it all the more important to pursue our mental health, and AA meetings or, you know, meetings of any kind and all kinds are a great part of that for a lot of people.
Right, exactly. Thank you.
Those things we just discussed, that's a pretty heavy load, or should I say loads, to carry. In a nutshell, if you could sum up, what has that been like for you making it up to this point now, going through all of that?
It's been so difficult, you know, because I was just at my doctor today with my psychiatrist, and he was saying, you know, this is like the worst time for alcoholics, is to be so isolated and not have our support system. It's been very difficult, and not being able to have any type of therapy, I mean, with the exception of you can do FaceTime, and unfortunately I was able to have an in-person meeting with my psychiatrist. That really helped. Really difficult, because I also am still dealing with the loss of my ex-husband, my children's father, and my son. It's a lot to deal with all in one fell swoop, you know.
Apart from your own struggles, you've been deeply impacted by hardships of some of those closest to you, such as your son, Julian.
Yeah, I lost my only son, and I still don't feel that we'll fully recover. I'll just learn to move forward and to do what I can to help others that are in his position or were in his position, and try to help them now. That's all I can do now, is help others, and that heals me. That helps me. I still have a daughter that I want to live healthy for, and so many kids that I do help that do depend on me. and I want to be there for them as well.
I'm so grateful that you have your daughter Paris. And one thing I need to say, if it's all right with you, about Julian is I've read that you said, and this really resonated with me, he took his own life, and I have some personal experience with that as well. And I just loved how you said that you don't exactly look at it in the traditional sense, but you look at it that he almost set himself free in a way. Could you elaborate on that a little bit?
My son suffered from severe schizophrenia, and I know how torturous it was, how horrific as it was of an illness, I would still rather have my son here, even though I know a part of him just couldn't deal with it anymore. I'd still rather, because that's how we are as human beings, you know, we're selfish in nature. We want our loved ones here at all costs, no matter what. So I would do anything to have my child back, despite the pain he was in.
Of course. And that's such an interesting concept, you know, selfishness, because it's not selfish for you to want your son to be here and for you to, you know, feel like you'd do anything to bring him back, him or Christoph, your very close friend, ex-husband, who passed just a few years later after Julian, right?
Right. He suffered, I think, like we were both suicidal after our son passed. But the difference between me and Christoph was that I was very outspoken about it. And I talked to anyone and everyone about my grief and anyone that would listen. And Christoph didn't. He was he kept it all bottled up inside until he finally just could not take it anymore. And I think that was the difference. He always tried to pretend he was okay. And me, I was just the complete opposite. No, I'm not okay. I was always reaching out for help. And he just, you know, is very much like has that man instinct where I'm not going to talk about it. I'm going to keep it all bottled inside. And I think that made it worse for him.
Yes, I'd have to agree that holding things in for anyone reaches a point that it just kind of boils over. And we're only human. Again, we can only take so much.
Right.
What would you say, if you were to elaborate a bit on, you know, not to make it a sexist thing, but let's just face it, the statistics tell us that men have a more difficult time expressing these thoughts and feelings, and perhaps that has something to do with how it's embedded in their brains, that they're supposed to be, what, macho or...
Right. Well, you know, with Christoph, he was very much the man of the family. He always tried to hold everybody together. Like the glue that always tried to fix things. Men like to fix, and he would always wanted to be the fixer, and he was good at it. You know, that's what he did. But while he spent so much time trying to hold everybody together, he himself was falling apart, and he needed to take care of himself. Unfortunately, he just couldn't do that.
And there's the very real aspect that he was somewhat of a public figure, right? I mean, he was an actor, and so he was somewhat in the public eye. I feel that sometimes in these situations, our loved ones and those we care about might feel that they'd rather us not see them at all than to see them at their weakest point.
Right. As you mentioned, you know, he's an actor. I mean, that's what he did best. He acted like he was okay. The truth was that he wasn't, but he was very good at what he did, and there were people that believed him. You know, I had known him since I was practically a teenager, so I knew he was not okay. He had to keep that I'm okay face on all the time, you know. I can fix this.
Yes, I think it's safe to say that maybe we all do that to a certain extent at one point or another. So it is very important to have, you know, a support system and people around us and even be okay with it in and of ourselves with our own inner security, to let our guard down, take our mask off. You know, I'm very grateful that he had you as a confidant in his life all that time. And I know it can be such a difficult load to carry like we've been talking about, but I just know in my heart that you as a mom and you as a wife and friend did absolutely everything within your power. At the end of the day, there's only so much within any of our control, right?
Right. Yeah, we have to come to that realization that we are powerless, because I could go over the last month of his life 1,000 times in my brain, and the truth is there's nothing anyone could have done. We're powerless. We can help and be there as much as we want, but in the end, ultimately, that person has to want to live. That person has to want to get better. We cannot give them the desire. You know, like they say in Alcoholics Anonymous, the only requirement is a desire. You just have to want it. But if you don't want it, there's not a damn thing anyone can do.
Preach. So true. When it comes to the mucky water of whether addiction is a disease or maybe mental illness in itself, what would you say about that?
I believe in my heart that alcoholism is truly an illness, and it's inherited. I know that I got this from my father. My sister didn't get it. My brother didn't get it. They're happy, normal drinkers. But me, I was the one child that did inherit alcoholism from my father. And Christoph's mother was an alcoholic, and he inherited that from her, even though he wasn't even raised with her. He still inherited the disease of alcoholism. And I knew that when I was very young. Like I said, I took my first drink, and for some reason, I just could not stop. And so it wasn't like I had built up to that. It was something that once it hit my system, I was just off and running. It did something to me that I could not comprehend. At such a young age, I didn't know what was happening to me.
Most 10-year-olds aren't going around drinking, so I feel like it almost had to be something, you know, already kind of within you. Like, I mean this in a figurative sense, but almost like a thirst, you know, and that brings up a very interesting and valid point about the whole aspect of DNA and genetics. Sometimes we carry things from different generations that we need to kind of address and work through, sometimes whether we realize it or not.
Right. I think that it's important to know what our history is, and it could help it may not have. I knew my dad was an alcoholic, and I swore I'd never be one, yet I became just like him. I tried to warn my children about alcohol and addiction. My children were raised in AA, but started drinking at a young age as well. My daughter, fortunately, does not drink anymore, but my son, unfortunately, became an addict, and that's what led him to the mental health facility, which inevitably led to his passing. So I definitely believe that it's something that runs in the family.
So what would you say, how does it work in the sense of maybe it affecting one family member and not the next? Does that boil down again to that desire and that matter of making a different decision?
I just feel like if you know it runs in your family, like I would always tell my kids, like, you cannot drink, you cannot use drugs, which I'm sure parents tell their kids all the time, but they're going to do what they're going to do, and all you can do is inform them, give them the tools to know what to do if they do get in that situation where they feel like they can't stop, that they do know where to go, and that's not a guarantee either. All we can do is educate our children and be there for them when they stumble. We're not going to be able to control them and their actions and what they do. We can just educate.
And that's the truth. The only control we really have is ultimately over ourselves. And so it can be really troubling when there's moments that we might feel that we lose that. So knowing, you know, that it runs in a family is one thing. Like we can know that consciously. It's not a whole embodiment decision to refrain and completely stay away and that sort of a thing. Then, you know, that's a different story.
Right.
Mia, would you agree with me that mental health, just overall, obviously with all these experiences and everything that you've been through, is not something that's taken seriously enough across the board? You know, your family, I feel, has suffered the brunt of some very real systematical failures.
Right. I believe that mental health is probably the most important thing in our lives. It's the most important thing we have, because if you're not happy, if you're not mentally well, then nothing is going to help you. Then it almost seems pointless, you know. You can have all the money in the world and all the cars and clothes, and what does it matter if you're not healthy, if you're mentally healthy, if you're not happy, if you're depressed, what does it matter if you have a Ferrari sitting in your driveway? I mean, it's just, it just seems pointless. So I think that mental health should be number one in all of our lives. And you're right, it's not taken seriously enough in this country.
What I've noticed is very interesting. You know, on one end, it's almost like they'll throw out a diagnosis without even thinking twice. And then on the other end, it's like so many are falling through the cracks because they're not getting the proper attention and the care plan and the management. So we're finding that balance of needing to take it seriously, of course, because we're in the middle of a crisis, and it's been that way for a while. But we also don't want to take it seriously to the point, you know, as a society where we would avoid places like Skid Row, for example, you know, where we kind of turn away from the people who need us the most because it's just too uncomfortable to go there. So, I mean, how does one even go about pursuing, Mia, their mental health? How did you get to that place, and what does that look like for you?
Always that way. I got a degree in psychology just to kind of find out why I was the way I was. I've always been curious and wanting to learn and wanting and seeking help. You know, like I said, that was the difference between me and Christoph. I was always telling people I'm not okay, I need help, you know, and talking to anyone that would talk to me and searching for this medication, that medication, therapy, that therapy, doctors from everywhere. And I've always been in a search to get better, to be better, to evolve.
I think that's also something that sets you apart, you know, because it can be much more comfortable in a sense to remain in our discomfort and not really take that responsibility or ownership to dissect, why am I making these decisions? Why am I finding myself in these types of cycles? And so you pursuing that kind of degree and really taking that long, hard look at yourself, I mean, there's really nothing more courageous than that. And I feel that, you know, when people hold things in, that's a type of strength. But when you go around and you're able to be open and honest about the fact that, hey, I need help. I'm struggling. This is where I'm at. I need you to meet me here. That takes a whole different type of strength, in my opinion.
I don't know if it's strength or just a desire just to want to be happy. Like, I just want to be happy. Desperation.
Right. You know, and I'll ask you about that word because for me personally, I live with some pain myself. I've had to kind of let go of the word happy. You know, I kind of think of it as more of like contentment, right? Because like you said at the beginning of our talk, there are things that we're going to be living with that are going to be heavy until we leave this, you know, planet. But what you're doing is so remarkable because you are turning your pain into power by giving what you've learned and digging deeper inside of yourself to show up and be there for other people so that maybe, just maybe, they won't have to endure some of the things that you have.
Right.
Let me ask you, what do you think the culprit is? Like, what is the problem? How are we falling short with managing these kind of situations and these ailments better for people?
I think as a society, we're uneducated. I guarantee you, you probably won't find one single person on the street right now if you ask 10 of them what schizophrenia is, that they'll know what it is and what it looks like. The majority of the people will pass by a homeless person talking to themselves and not just say, oh, they're crazy, and not talk to them, not reach out to help them because they're uneducated. They don't know. And they just call them a bum or whatever. So I think as a society, we have to educate children at an early age, what is mental illness? What does that look? What does it look like? Because you might see someone who's just an asshole, or you think is just an asshole, and being rude and mean, but not realizing that that person could be suffering from paranoid schizophrenia. We're so uneducated in mental illness that it's hard to, like, for people to have compassion. Like I said, most people just pass a homeless person on the street and not say one word to him. Are you okay? Do you need anything? What's your name? They'll just ignore them like they don't exist, like they're invisible people. If they're laying on the street, you'll just walk over them. No one's going to stop and say, oh man, are you okay? We need to be educated, and that goes for all of us, everybody as a society, even, and educate yourself. Your school's not teaching you, your parents aren't teaching you. Educate yourself, and that's what I did. I wasn't learning what was wrong with me in school, and my parents certainly weren't telling me, so I went and got a degree because I said, I'm going to learn and see if I can diagnose my damn self. If you can't learn it out from your peers or your family, then I encourage everyone to educate themselves.
Yes, and that's what we have to do. In these days, more than ever, maybe we can't always trust exactly what's handed to us, and so we need to dig deeper. And I think that something this pandemic has unraveled is the fact that everybody has mental health, or not. We've been confronted with maybe aspects of ourselves that we really haven't had to sit down and explore before. We know that mental health is just as important as any other part of health within us, because without it, can we really truly be healthy?
Right. No, it's everything.
So it's worth our effort, even though it's hard and even though it's strenuous and even though, you know, it doesn't always feel good. It's either, you know, are we going to sit with this darkness and sometimes let it kind of swallow us whole, or are we going to stand up to it and take a stand against it and not let it control us all the time?
Right.
For the person who is on the edge right now, what is the first thing that comes to your mind that you would say? Think back to maybe even recently at a time that you were struggling. What health, where can you go in your mind? What can get us through those toughest moments when we're really just left facing it all and taking it all on ourselves?
Wow, it's tough, but the one thing that always gets me back to my sanity is when people say to pray. And I don't mean pray like being religious. I mean pray to your higher self, your higher consciousness, to help you bring you back to sanity or to a healthy state. And I just pray, or you can call it meditation, whatever you want to call it. But I talk to my higher self, and it's good to be reminded of that I have a higher consciousness that's higher than me that will guide me and will help me. And I have to reach out to that consciousness. And some people might call it God. Some people might call it their higher power or the universe, their higher consciousness, whatever you want to call it. But that's what helps me.
Well, there's almost like a deeper well that you have within yourself that you kind of pull from when you really need to. And maybe that well has been developed from all of the decisions that you've made to continue on up until this point. You know, I like to sometimes for myself think back when things get rough.
Driving her the whole time. I've loved the conversation that you guys are having, and I can definitely relate.
Hi. Who, can I ask who this is?
I said I'm her daughter.
Oh, Paris. Hi, Paris. Oh, what a pleasure to meet you too on the line.
Yeah.
That's great. Okay, hi. Welcome. Yeah, you're more than welcome to this conversation.
Yeah.
Also, did I hear a dog too?
Yeah, very accurate. Yeah, we've all been a part of this really beneficial conversation that you guys have been having.
I'm so glad. Yes, it's very meaningful to all of us as well. Can I ask both of you then? We know that education is important, and I think that's extremely valuable. When we're going through a hard time, we want everyone to turn their back or not to be there for us. We could kind of start putting ourselves in each other's shoes. I think that would be a good start.
Yeah, but I also think be there for others and to kind of know that we're all going through, we're all fighting a battle you know nothing about, and we're all like on that same journey to find wellness. We're all trying to find the same answers, right? And some of us look within and some of us look outside of us, but it's all the same. We're looking for the same kind of happiness. And I heard you mentioning that earlier, that you are still trying to figure out what happy actually means to you. But, you know, for lack of a better word, we're trying to find happiness and success and confidence and to feel expressed, multitude of gifts that we want to have. But I also think that we can't necessarily always look to others to understand that. And that's why these conversations are so important, to know that, you know, there are people who are encouraging all of us, even if the bigger voice of the world is not speaking out about mental health. I think we still just need to trust ourselves, know what we ourselves as individuals need, even if we're not being given the permission or the encouragement to take action and to take the steps that we individually need for ourselves, because not everybody's mental health is the same. We need to be able to take that initiative for ourselves and not look for permission from others to be well for ourselves. So that's what I think.
Ditto.
And I know my mom was saying prayer and meditation are very helpful tools. I second that, and I also think that the way I do it, as you might have been able to tell from just what I've been talking about, for me it's creativity, finding what works for you. Prayer and meditation are a very great place to start. You can find that benefit that you get from prayer and meditation in your own kind of activity. For me, it's finding something creative to that wellness within me.
Wow. I'm blown away. and I concur with your every word. You know, that's a really tough realization to come to sometimes, that we really are the sailors of our own boats, if you will, in life. And we do have to make those powerful decisions. And what you both have been able to do and have done and continue to do is stand affirm and claim your space and use, you know, whatever outlets align to keep a fire in your soul that fuels the good stuff, right? Because we all kind of have two fires at any given time, and kind of depends on where we're going to be putting the fuel, and that can kind of dictate our perception and the route of our thoughts and so on and so forth. So how encouraging is it to learn that we can kind of take an exit ramp on this kind of not so good stuff? And you know what, if you two are on this line talking to me about happiness, I'm a firm believer in it. And I'm so grateful that you've held on to that for yourselves, honestly. And it really, really, I'm hoping everybody else's fire is lit right now the way that mine is. It's hopeful, and I feel that's what we need. That's what we just all need.
Thank you. You, with your powerful words and insight, have helped light the right kind of fire in me, and it's I feel so grateful to have that feeling, because you're right. There can be two different kinds of fires at any given time, and it's always about the choice. You're going to choose to not give up and to keep fueling that positive fire, that passion and that love for life, and to keep going. For me, I'm always battling the two, and that's why mental health is such an important part of my life, because I always have to pay attention to that. I always have to focus on that, because I can take the wrong path at any given moment.
It happens. It happens because these fires are simultaneous. You know, it's not like there's one sometimes and the other. They're kind of both firing up at once. And so I'm curious what you both would say. You know, we talked about education and just kind of getting the word out there and not maybe turning our back the next time that we're confronted with someone in need. What else? What comes to mind that we could do immediately, like right now, if we all just feel so passionate about supporting this type of cause? What is something that we can all do?
I would say care about one another. And like I said, if you do see a homeless person or someone in need, stop and talk to that person. Other than educate yourself, help someone else in need. Step out of yourself, especially when you're feeling like shit yourself or depressed. Step out of yourself and help someone else. And that will inevitably help you.
And for me, it's about being honest. I think you can help people by being honest about what you're going through.
In order to do that, we have to first be honest with ourselves, and that can kind of be the tough part to start. So
yeah.
if maybe I wanted to venture a little bit deeper into mental health, maybe I'm someone that just kind of heard about this idea, I'm wrapping my mind around it. Oh, really? That's a part of me? Okay. What do I do now? Where do I go from here? What would be your advice, I guess, if you will? Where could I start with this prayer stuff, this meditation stuff, this self-care on a whole new level that I may have never even thought about before?
Well, we're so lucky. I mean, the millennials and the younger generations, younger than me, they're so lucky that now they have the internet. I mean, Google meditation. That's what I do now when I need a new meditation. I usually listen to Deepak Chopra, but we're so fortunate now that we can go on Google and find anything. Whereas when I was a kid, it was go to the library, go to get an encyclopedia, and there was just such little information out there. And now we just have a world of information, you know, on the internet. You can find almost anything.
For me, Yahoo. Just about yahoo.com. No, I agree with what you said. For me, it's about doing what you love and trusting that, and have like harmony with your mental, emotional, physical, and like spiritual health and well-being.
It's
about listening to yourself, and this just ties into what I was saying earlier, like knowing what you need, like, and I think you can know what you need, like, just by being honest with yourself. And I think it's just like giving into your love, giving into your passions. That is like the good fire in you. And I think the more you can do what you love, like the more you find that, hey, actually this is the answer. And then you start to develop a routine with that included in it, because you see that this is something that actually contributes to your mental health. And it's like, hey, when I do this thing, that thing and this thing over here and that thing over there, I feel so much better. And it's something maybe that's not logical. It's not taught to you in schools. It's not spoken about maybe by your peers or people around you, or maybe it is. Keep doing the things that you know that makes you feel inside, because it's not about how it makes your mom feel or somebody else feel. It's about how it makes you feel. And if you feel that healing taking place, and it could be something so simple, like listening to a song, listening to music. For me, I love music. I love dancing. Dancing is the non-negotiable part of my routine. Without it, my mental health is destroyed. Singing, walking my dog, prayer, meditation. So it really is finding, just trusting what you love and finding it to be, finding little things you can make a part of your routine and that become non-negotiable. It'll become obvious.
Anyone or anything outside of ourselves can only take us so far. And then we're left having to find balance and meaning and purpose through digging maybe through what seems like ashes or broken pieces of quality of life. You know, and so to obtain that again is not only a desire and a personal choice, but it's that execution piece. You know, it's following up on the resources that we have on our disposal. It's making it real for ourselves. Like you so beautifully stated, it's not going to look the same from one person to another, and that's perfectly normal, natural, and okay. And so, Mia, I just want to ask you, what has been the greatest lesson that you've learned thus far that could be applied to both inside the ring of boxing as well as the ring of life?
The number one thing that comes to mind is always getting back up. You get knocked down, you get back up. And there's times, even in the ring, you feel like you don't want to get up. Probably times in the ring where you really shouldn't. But always in life, like, you always should get up. You always get up and you always keep fighting. And that's what I remind myself every day is not giving up. Keep moving forward. Keep coming. And you know, that's kind of how I was in the ring anyway, was always just keep coming. And I won so many of my fights that way. Not because, like, in the beginning I wasn't the greatest fighter, but I just wouldn't stop. Like, I just would not let up. There was no quit in me. You know, I was going to beat you into submission and come at you like a Mack truck. Like, and that's how my sister always said, that's how I am in life. I'm just like that Mack truck coming down the street, and I just won't stop. You know, it's just always been in me to be a fighter. So I'm certainly not going to give up now.
I know, that's right. Surviving can be summed up by just not giving up. And it sounds really easy to just kind of put that phrase together and call it a day. We know that it's not easy. And so, again, I just want to say that to me, you're a conqueror in every sense of the word. And Paris, I can't express what an honor it also was to have you on. I did not anticipate that. And I'm just curious as to is there anything else or any closing remarks that you want to leave our listeners with?
Yeah, if anyone wants more information or to email me, I get tons of emails every day, and I try to answer them as much as I can, and I get a lot of messages on social media. So you can reach me at MiaSt.JohnFoundation.org, or which is my website, or you can go on Twitter at MiaSt.JohnBoxer or Instagram at MiaSt.JohnBoxer. And I'm on there. And I, like I said, I try to answer as many messages as I can.
Her mentality has helped me in my life, crossed over into my life. And there are so many times where I do want to give up in my own ways, because of my own pain. And I think it's okay. I just want anybody listening to know, off of what my mom was saying, it's okay to feel like you want to give up sometimes, or to feel like you're most, just to feel your worst and to feel negative. And it's okay to have to deal with that on an ongoing basis. I mean, that's kind of the definition of, you know, having a mental illness or a mental disorder, is that you can come back. If we can come back from such a rock bottom and being suicidal in our own ways and not being okay in our own ways, if we can hang on, then I know that anybody else can.
Paris, take your time getting out there, and your healing journey is your own, just like the rest of us. And we're all just taking things a moment at a time, and it's very important that everyone knows that we all reach these points, and it makes us human. What else is there to say, really? That's so lovely. Thank you both so much. You guys,
thank
you heard it here.
So
the one and only Mia St. John and the wonderful Paris. You are both legends, and thank you again so much for making the time to be with us
today.
Thank
you so much. Thank
you for the opportunity. It's a great for everybody.
Okay.
Keep doing it.
Thank you. Yes,
bye.
We will. And you do the same. Take care.
I feel it too. Come on with me. We'll make it through. We're here. We're strong.